Ronnie Darwish. I'm filling in for the one and only Jamie Glazov. And this is the Glazov Gang. I'm honored to have with us today a very special guest, Dr. Jim Toll. And he is senior pastor of El Camino Metro Church in Los Angeles. Pastor Jim Toll is one of the most inspiring pastors in America. And he has established several churches, hundreds of churches actually, all over the United States and the world, especially in South America. He preaches four times every Sunday morning in both English and Spanish. And I'm privileged to call him my pastor. Welcome, Pastor Jim.
Thank you, Nani. It's a joy to be here with you, and especially on Jamie's program on his show.
Well, our discussion today is something that really needs somebody like you, somebody who understands, fully understands the Bible. I have become a Christian, but I still feel, I'm ashamed to say that I really still need to understand the Bible better. And there's nobody better than you to explain this to me and to the audience. I want to discuss today the importance of values in our society. Does culture matter? Do values matter? What do you think?
Well, first of all, thank you for letting me share these moments with you. And you honor me by saying that I'm an expert and know the Bible very well. I don't know that I know it very well, but I keep studying it because the topic of God is so much grander than any of us. But he's merciful and he's kind towards us. And you do very well at it yourself. Is the subject of values germane or important for today's culture? Yes, absolutely. Because if you don't have some type of values, you have what I would call a rudderless ship, a ship that has no direction. I'm a pilot, and you get to your destination by the rudder in the airplane that controls your lateral movement. And you can't go left or right or east or west without some direction. Values give you direction. And if it's relativism, then today it's one idea, and tomorrow a competing idea goes against that. And so you have what I call vacillation. You're going back and forth, and that doesn't provide anything of stability or order to the culture. So values do very much matter.
But today in America, the intelligentsia and the media tells us that everything is relative. Religion, all religions are equal. All cultures are equal. But at the same time, they don't explain to us why there are so many people from all over the world who want to move to America, while at the same time, all these critics in America who are constantly criticizing America, constantly criticizing the Judeo-Christian values, but they don't move to those countries that they think they are totally equal to America. So this is a contradiction that I cannot understand how they feel comfortable with it.
Well, I think they feel comfortable because they're trying to justify how they live, and they've not truly explored if I could call it this way, the many different options. You cannot say all religions are equal because religions of different types and stripes, I like to say, have different claims that sometimes are very opposing. So how can they be equal? I teach my children. I have four grown sons who have four grown wives and a bunch of children. I teach them that they are of same value and worth as their wives are. The wife is of same value, but they're not equal. The male body is different from the female body. So you can't talk about equality without introducing a bigger subject matter, and that's the subject matter about truth and definitions and values and assignments that we all have in life. And the problem that we have with people who are critical of either the Judeo-Christian ethic or values or worldview is that they've not truly studied it. They try to look at one example where maybe there's been abuse, and then they assume that the other religions, where they say whatever they want to say, is of equal importance. You can't give equal importance to everything. You have to study it. You have to analyze it. You have to test it.
I was born a Muslim, as you know, and it took me a long time to really adjust to some of the, you know, the differences. I was very, very appreciative of the Judeo-Christian culture, the values I learned in America. And I would like to mention some of the values that I grew up with as a Muslim, and I would like to hear from you the corresponding biblical values of the same concept. For instance, the concept of sin. The Quran never describes Muslims or Muhammad, who is the founder of Islam. The Quran never refers to Muslims, or I never felt, as when I was a Muslim, I was never told that we were all sinners. This concept of sin and sinners in the Quran is always attributed to non-Muslims. So the Quran shames Jews and Christians by admitting, because the Jews and Christians admitted their sin in their holy books. The Bible speak about the sin of the Jews and the Christians. And what happened is the Islam uses that admittance of being sinful, the sinful nature of humanity in the Bible. It points at it as this is the proof that they are evil and bad and sinners, and they are not innocent. So how do you find the concept of sin in the Bible in that reference?
Well, I'm not a student of Islam. I respect all Muslims, but I do believe that Christ, specifically Christ, Jesus Christ, has come to deal with the primary topic of sin. There's not a person in the world that doesn't contradict themselves. All of us have made promises to ourselves and not been able to fulfill that promise. Now, that in itself isn't violating something of God, but that is in itself proof that there's something wrong with our apparatus. There's something wrong with our emotions, or there's something wrong with our spiritual nature. That we can promise ourselves that we'll do something, and then we don't do it, and we contradict it in ourselves. That's a proof that we're sin nature. The concept of sin is very simple. If we were to draw a circle anywhere on a blackboard or on a chalkboard, and then put a point in the middle of it, sin is missing. If you were to throw something at that circle, sin is missing the circle. So sin is missing the ideal, God's ideal, or even our ideal.
Christians consider themselves all sinners?
All Christians consider themselves to be some type of sinner. That doesn't mean that we accept that sin.
No.
We are born with that sin, and from the earliest time that a baby begins to assert its will, you watch anger, you watch selfishness. We consider those things to be sin. And so the whole idea, whether it's Judaism or Christianity, believes that there is sacrifice for forgiving us our sins, and then there is a strength that comes from God to surmount or to win over those areas of weakness in our human lives. There's not a Muslim in the world, there's not a Buddhist in the world,
who
there's not a Christian that doesn't have weaknesses. We all have our weaknesses. We call that sin, and to deny sin in one's life is to pretend that you are perfect and equal with God. Nobody's equal with God. No Muslim considers himself to be equal with Allah. And so to consider oneself to be sinless or above sin is to basically say that you are infinite and you are perfect. And none of us believe we're perfect.
When I became Christian, Pastor Jim, I really felt very comfortable, and almost my... I felt, when I was a Muslim, I felt like I was carrying a load. I was carrying a burden. And when I became a Christian, I felt the burden has been lifted. And one of the reasons is the idea that we're all sinners. This is never said in Islam. Islam is constantly, if you read the Quran, and I don't know if you read it or not, but if you read the Quran, it's constantly shaming, blaming, and condemning non-Muslims as sinful people. And it's called in Islam infidels. And this is the worst crime you can ever do, to be a non-Muslim. And in it, Islam is constantly obsessed with pointing fingers at non-Muslims as being sinful. Non-members of the religion, like 61% of the Quran is consumed with non-members of the religion,
okay,
whom they call kafir, which means infidel. And so Muslims are constantly trying to fix the outside world rather than fixing themselves. And this is what I discovered.
Our Bible says very specifically, don't judge anyone else.
Yeah.
Or else you bring judgment on yourself. Mm-hmm. The issue of sin, everybody actually proves to themselves and to others that they're sinners. Everybody in the world. Because we either try to get somebody's acceptance, mm. God's acceptance, or somebody else's acceptance, or we try to improve, and we try to prove that we're not bad. If you are totally good, why do you have to prove that you're not bad?
Exactly. So, but Muslims are constantly trying to prove they are not bad.
And we're trying to prove many times before God that we deserve his favor, so we do things. Mm. That is in itself a proof of inadequacy, that we've not arrived, and that is our definition of sin. Mm. So we as Christians, we come before God and we say, we admit to you, God, that there are these deficiencies in ourselves. He doesn't condemn us. Jesus said, I don't come to condemn you. Mm-hmm. I come to give you life and give you freedom. I come to forgive you. I come to put my nature or my spirit inside of you so that you become free. You mentioned carrying a load.
A load,
that
yes.
You felt that you were always carrying a load.
Yeah.
Our scriptures tell us what that load is. Mm-hmm. That load is the subconscious spiritual reality that we're carrying around the weight of our inadequacy. Mm-hmm. We're carrying around either our guilt or our shame. Mm-hmm. We're carrying around our fears. We're carrying mm-hmm. around our inadequacies, our attempts to mm-hmm. to be good enough to warrant God's yeah. acceptance to us.
Islam, unfortunately, assigned itself a job, which is to save humanity. So every Muslim is advised that they can conquer the non-Muslim world in order to save them from themselves. And so this causes a lot of bloody borders. Wherever Islam is, there's bloody borders, because it's all constantly a confrontation. And in order to achieve this conquering spirit that Islam has, there is nothing that a Muslim cannot do. They can kill, it's legal.
Okay.
They can lie, they can slander, they can, it's not only legal to lie, it's actually an obligation to lie and slander, if it's for the benefit of Islam, if it's for the benefit of the expansion of Islam. This is mainstream Islamic law.
So, because I'm not a student of Islam, and I'm not going to judge Islam, but I'm trying to
yeah.
understand it.
But this makes
Islam,
it's
would
the
this
exactly
have to do with Allah and Muhammad
yeah.
as well, that they believe in deception and lies
yeah, deception.
And trickery?
Actually, Allah himself called himself in the Quran, I am the greatest deceiver. And this was in the Quran. So you're almost competing with God on who can deceive the other one.
Well, if deception is the baseline, if
yeah.
Deception is the foundation
yes.
of a belief structure or a theology or a philosophy, then you have nothing upon which to build.
You can't.
You cannot build anything. You can't build friendship. You
Trust.
Can't build marriage.
Trust.
Exactly. In the Christian God, God
yes.
Almighty,
yes.
God is truth.
Exactly.
And Satan is the deceiver.
Yeah.
And so God is in a war through his people, not against people, but against Satan. And he asks people to be empowered by him to resist the temptations of Satan, who uses trickery and deceit, force and obligation, fear against people.
Yeah.
And so Christianity is based on truth.
Yeah, and I've discovered that because when I came to America, again, I used to give excuses for instance, if I'm opening my house door to go out to do something and an Egyptian friend comes in and she would ask me, oh, were you leaving? Can I come in? And she said, oh, no, I'm not leaving. Come in. So yes is not yes and no is not no.
Well, our scriptures basically say, let your yes always be yes. In other words, don't say yes when you mean no. And don't say no when you mean yes. Let your yes
be
yes.
In Islam, the yes can be no, and the no can be yes.
Well, then what can you base any conversation on? What can you base any relationship on? My wife needs my trust. I need my wife's trust. I have friends that are my neighbors. I want them to trust me. I want to trust them. And so honesty and transparency and truth are the basis of all solid relationships. That's why we Christians don't say that we're in a religion. We're actually in a relationship with a person whose name is Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Well, these values are the fruits that America has, the biblical values.
That's correct.
Upon which our Constitution was built, our great nation, America, was built. And the reason the Middle East is in fire, it's in chaos, in my opinion, is because of the confused values that I grew up with. And I'm just very thankful for America that gave me the chance to move to this country and appreciate the biblical values. And I just hope, Pastor Jim, that the American people understand that without the biblical values, what do you think, without the biblical values, where is America heading? Where is America heading?
Well, if we don't hold to truth, if we don't hold to those values, if we don't hold to the values that made us strong, which are love your neighbor as yourself, which are truth. Jesus Christ said, I am the truth and the light and the life. If we don't hold to those values, then things begin to erode and everything becomes relative. And so only the strong will prevail over the other people.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we want is we want all people to respect each other. And the way that we get that respect is through Jesus Christ, because he respected us to come and deal with our sins.
Well, respect and trust are the most important thing for a society to flourish and become this great nation that we have here in America. Thank you, Pastor Jim Paul. I really appreciate coming to the Glazov gang, and we'll see you next time with another guest. Good night.